The Institute of Chartered Accountants of India is the world's second largest accounting and auditing body. The Institute has proudly completed 70 years of providing excellence and has coined a new theme, celebrating the past, inspiring the future. The theme for the 30th annual international seminar is People, Purpose and Passion, the Pathway to Progress.
Investing is an art which requires a team of good people. It's actually a blend of three important P's. It is team of good people, a common purpose of generating enough return for investors, and a passion to work for such purpose, which can drive people to edges for the best results. We are very privileged to have such a learned authority on the investing, and I like to invite our committee member, CA Rajesh, to please come over and welcome him.
Hello everyone. My name is Rajesh, committee member of ICI Abu Dhabi chapter. Before I introduce our next speaker, I have something interesting to tell. So our Abu Dhabi chapter has gone live on Twitter recently. So we have put a profile of CA Nilesh Shah once he has confirmed for the annual international seminar as a speaker. Unbelievably, within one day, in fact, less than one day, we got 10,000 impressions for his profile. Such is the following of CA Nilesh Shah. With this, I would like to invite CA Nilesh Shah for the next session. Can I ask our team to play the introductory video?
CA Nilesh Shah is the Managing Director of Kotak Mahindra Asset Management Company Limited. Mr. Nilesh Shah has over 25 years of experience in capital markets and market-related investments, having managed funds across equity, fixed income securities and real estate for local and global investors. In his previous assignments, Nilesh has held leadership roles with Axis Capital, ICICI Prudential Asset Management, Franklin Templeton and ICICI Securities. Nilesh is the recipient of the inaugural Business Standard Fund Manager of the Year Award, DET, in 2004. He was part of the team that received the Best Fund House of the Year Award at Franklin Templeton, as well as at ICICI Prudential. Nilesh is a gold medalist chartered accountant and a merit ranking cost accountant. His hobbies include reading and educating investors on financial planning. He has co-authored a book on financial planning called A Direct Take.
Welcome, sir.
In the world of business, Madrasi becoming successful is unique. And Dr. Vellumanni very humorously described what makes him successful or what are the key ingredients of success. In the investment also, it is possible for a Madrasi to become successful. It is not the prerogative of a Sindhi or a Gujarati or Marwadi. This also requires just basic common sense, hard work, and all the ingredients which Dr. Vellumanni described. Very recently, I came across an article which actually propounded this fact, and I have taken down notes because it was difficult to remember the entire article. There was a lady called Grace Groner. She died leaving $7 million for a university in US at the age of 70. She was born in a poor family. She never married. She didn't have obviously any kids. She wasn't working in a high profile job that she could have $7 million to give to a university. In fact, most people thought, where did this lady got $7 million? And afterwards, when someone went through her accounts, this was all doing by making very, very small investments from her savings. She lived the life frugally, saved money, and more importantly, invested that money wisely. Around the same time, after Grace Groner declared $7 million for university, there was another news about a gentleman called Richard Fuscon. He was the former vice chairman of Merrill Lynch's Latin America division. He was a Harvard graduate, and he declared personal bankruptcy. He was the gentleman who worked in Merrill Lynch for decades and made so much money that at 40 years of age, he decided to retire by doing charitable activity. But by 2008, when the financial crisis came, he was down to such an extent that he had to file for a personal bankruptcy. What did Richard do? Despite having a Harvard degree, despite working in Bank of America, Merrill Lynch, was essentially running leveraged position, essentially doing illiquid investment, essentially doing trading, and in the end, he ended up becoming personal defaulter. Very rarely it's possible in a professional field that someone who doesn't know how to perform heart surgery becomes an expert doctor, and someone who has been educated at Harvard or Johns Hopkins fails to perform heart surgery. But in the field of investment, a Grace Groner can easily outperform Richard simply because one follows discipline, one follows investment, one gets his passion, one gets his purpose. And this is what I want to convey to all of you. It's possible for you to become far better investors than many professional fund managers if you get your purpose and your passion right. I want to talk about the purpose and the passion of the number 1% in our country. And it's very easy to blame someone like him for anything which is going wrong in the country. But hopefully after this presentation, you'll be able to appreciate the challenges which he is facing. In India's case, we are a country which never disappoints anyone. If you are optimist about India, we'll give you 10 reasons to be bullish about India. And at the same time, if you are pessimist about India, we'll give you 10 reasons to be bearish about India at the same time. And I'm sure if I divide this group in two parts, there'll be many people who will be bearish on India for a variety of things. And there will be a similar number of people who will be bullish on India for a variety of things. Let's take a look at how India is shaping. I have a very short story to tell people about India, why it is such a great country. You look at this chart carefully, you will see one white line going up. That's the price chart of a company called Maruti Suzuki. It's India's largest automobile company. It has become 11th largest automobile company in the world. It is owned 53% by Suzuki of Japan. Every 100 rupee which Maruti makes, they pay 40 rupees by way of royalty to Suzuki. And over last 15 years, since 2003, it has consistently delivered return, notwithstanding the fact that in recent time it is down about 30% from top. If you focus very hard, you will see there is a blue, yellow, and green line also trying to come up from the bottom of the chart. That's the price chart of Toyota, Honda, Suzuki, and Nissan. Just look at the return delivered by Maruti Suzuki vis-a-vis all the other Japanese companies put together. Maruti single-handedly has delivered more return then Honda, Toyota, Nissan, and Suzuki put together. Gujarati mein kahawat hai, baap karta beto sawayo. If you want a living proof, Maruti, the beta is bigger than the baap Suzuki. This is the opportunity of India. We will produce companies, we will produce entrepreneurs, which will be far better than the world at today's point of time. Now, obviously, there is risk. There's a saying in Japanese which says that unless you enter tiger's cave, you can't catch its cub. So when you're operating in India, you have to live with the risk. This is the photograph from Maruti's factory in Manesar. Very recently, a leopard entered their factory. They shut down the making of automobiles, isolated that factory area, called jungle authorities, tranquilized the leopard, send it back to jungle, and started making car again. This kind of adventure, this kind of thrill is not available in Honda and Toyota's factory. It's only available in India. Kabhi-kabhi market mein bhi leopard aa jata hai. If you don't become leopard's food, then you will make enough money. Last 1 year has been particularly tough for India. If you had seen a movie called Perfect Storm by George Clooney, you will realize how Indian economy was going through. Oil prices went up from $55 to $80. That resulted into India's current account deficit widening, and that pushed Indian economy down. Fortunately, in recent times, oil prices have corrected. Probably bad for this part of the world, but significantly better for the part of the world in which I am coming from. As oil prices went up, rupee depreciated. All of you are non-resident investors doing dollar investment. And over last 1 year, your Indian investments have given negative return because rupee went down by 14%. Rupee has a habit of moving in a very non-asymmetrical manner. From 2013 to 2017, rupee appreciated from 68 to 63. And in 2018, it covered for previous 4 years by depreciating at 14%. Hopefully, now rupee is stabilizing. It's appreciating a little bit. The worst of the rupee seems to be behind us. We also had a scenario where interest rates went up. Fortunately, now interest rates have started coming down. We also had a scenario where banking liquidity tightened from positive, it became negative. We were unable to provide money to our banks, which can go out and lend money to entrepreneurs. And because of that, we also saw an event called ILFS, which moved from AAA to D in 45 days. Clearly, all the volatility from rupee, oil, interest rates, liquidity, credit event came and hit Indian economy. And this came on top of the fact that India was outperforming all other emerging markets. In just last 5 years, we are one of the few emerging markets which have delivered positive return in US dollar terms. Everyone else has delivered negative return. Put all these things together, we saw Indian equity market correcting big time. In dollar terms, large cap went down 20%, mid cap went down 30%, and small cap went down 50%. So today when you look at your equity portfolios, it looks all red, primarily because Indian economy was caught in a perfect storm. is things now changing? Yes, I believe so. We believe majority of bad news is already priced into the market. And from here onwards, hopefully, there will be limited bad news. 1 rupee is now reasonably corrected. From here onwards, it won't go down by another 14% in a year. Maybe in 5 years, yes. Interest rates are one of the highest in real sense in the global market. There are very few countries which offer as high interest rates as India today. Even compared to US interest rates, we are in a reasonably good position. The Reserve Bank of India finally have started realizing that they need to provide liquidity, and they have started taking some corrective steps. For ILFS, like Satyam, an empowered group of people have been given to run the company. Hopefully, they'll figure out how to manage this. Most importantly, Indian markets have started seeing earnings growth. Profitability after years of subduedness has started improving, and that should support equity market. Most importantly, from outside investor point of view, the valuations have become from premium to reasonable, from expensive to fair value. The small cap index was trading at 34% premium to historical leverage on 16th of Jan. Today it is trading at minus 5% discount. Large cap was at 10% premium. Today it is minus 2% discount. Mid cap was at 33% premium. Today it is at 11% premium. So effectively now you are entering India at most reasonable price. This is another way to look at it. If we compare India's outperformance vis-a-vis other emerging market, then based on those two parameters also, it's looking like as if India is becoming interesting to invest into. Now, these are all short-term stories, and there is also a hot topic going on about India where there is some spat between RBI and government. I'm sure local media will be highlighting this quite reasonably well over here. You hear stories as if governor is going to resign, as if RBI's independence has been compromised. We think it's not a confrontation between RBI and government. It's just that government wants more speed, and RBI is providing little less speed than what government needs. For running any economy, you require 3 things. 1, liquidity. 2, transmission. And 3, pricing. There are very few entrepreneurs like Dr. Velumani who doesn't borrow money. Most entrepreneurs build businesses by borrowing money, by leveraging their meager capital. In services, probably asset-light model can work, but you can't set up a steel plant without borrowing. Today, in India's tank, petrol has been filled much less than what is needed. It is good for 5-6% growth, but government wants to achieve 8-10% growth. How do you achieve speed without putting petrol in your tank? That's the difference. It's not that RBI hasn't put any petrol, but government believes the petrol put by RBI is good for 5-6% speed. They need it 10% speed. The second thing is transmission. You provide money to Tata, Birla, Ambani, they will create one amount of growth. You go down to the bottom level, reaching out to entrepreneurs from Kashmir to Kanyakumari, it creates another level of growth. Today, transmission of credit is compromised. And finally, the cost of credit is reasonably high. We believe hopefully RBI and government will reach some midway point. Probably RBI will accept that instead of 5 or 6, 7 or 8 is better. Government will accept that instead of 9, 10, let's run at 7 or 8 for a while. And hopefully these things will become out of headline. What is more important? What's the long story of India? If you have to invest in India, you're not investing for 3 months, 6 months, 9 months, 12 months. You are taking a call for 5 years, 10 years. You can't create Dr. Vellu Mani in 1 year. It requires 23 years. So what will happen over next 20, 25 years in India? Today morning, I was meeting some investors in Abu Dhabi. And they talked about one seminar which was done over here where Arundhati Bhattacharya had come and some gentleman from US had come. And he gave a fairly negative picture of India. Now, this is the thing which we are quite used to. Most of the guys who have left India, they are generally anti-India. It may not be true over here, but especially people who are coming from US, they believe US is a great country and India has been left behind. These are the people who have no idea about India. Their knowledge is restricted to 30, 40 years before when they left India. Let me share with you some of the problems which our number one person is facing. The first problem which India is facing is diversity. Our smallest state, Goa, has population equivalent to Estonia. And the largest state, UP, has population equal to Brazil. So when the number one person is running the country, he's running Estonia to Brazil together. There are very few countries which are as complex as we are. If that population complexity was not good enough, we have complexity in terms of distribution of income. The richest state, Delhi, is as rich as Indonesia, about $9,000 per capita income. The poorest state, UP, is as poorer as Nepal. When you are running India, you are running a continent. When we go to meet foreigners, especially Goras, we normally ask them one question, do you believe in God? Most of them reply back saying that no, we are atheist. And that's the answer we need, because then we immediately request him to visit India, they will start believing in God. If this damn thing is running, there must be someone looking at us from the top. The second problem which India faces is that we are most lousiest allocator of savings. We are a poor country, no doubt about it. We want to invest money for building our infrastructure. But we are following our forefathers' dictum of Atithi Devo Bhava. So we are sending our capital abroad. In just 17 years, from 2000 to 2017, we have remitted $427 billion abroad for import of gold. And puri duniya mein jhola ghuma ke sirf $294 billion apne paas aaya hai. This is like a patient who is admitted into ICU and instead of receiving blood, it is giving blood donation. And then he is complaining to doctor that I am not getting cured. First stop your hemorrhage, you will get cured automatically. This obsession for gold, which Indians have possessed, has kept India behind for generations. The third thing is that India is situated in Africa. In the geography book, we were told that India is in Asia, but that's a complete lie. We are actually in Africa. Our tax compliance, and a lot of it can attribute to our professional community, is ensuring that our tax compliance standards are lower than many of the African nations. We are not worthy of saying that we belong to a neighborhood where Pakistan, Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, and Nepal is there. Because our tax compliance are comparable to Rwanda, Ethiopia, Nigeria, Kenya. It's not comparable to Bangladesh and Sri Lanka. I am a Gujju bhai, and I'm sure there will be many Gujaratis here. All my cousin brothers have bigger cars and bigger houses than me. And in their lifetime, they have not paid tax collectively, which I pay it in 1 year. This is the nation of dishonest people in terms of payment of taxes. And professionally, our community has contributed a lot, wholeheartedly. The fourth issue, we have shortage of people like Dr. Vellumani. They don't create enough jobs. And because of that, everyone wants a reservation in government jobs. If you don't create enough jobs for your young people, how does country grow? So within those four challenges, we are trying to change our past. I'm quite hopeful that because of these four things, India's future is far brighter than what it was in the past. It's not that we have been a miserable failure. We have created in India 7% nation which is enjoying life of Australia. So 7% Indians today are living life like Australia. Majority of us will belong into that category. 20% of Indians live life of Filipinos. And rest of the guys live in a standard which is comparable to sub-Saharan Africa. So when you want to talk positive about India, you can focus on that 27% Australians and Filipino equivalent, you will feel good. If you want to talk bad about India, you can focus on sub-Saharan Africa population and you will feel good. As I mentioned, we have reasons to make people bullish and we have reasons to make people bearish. Let's talk about the first mega trend which is happening in India, inefficiency to efficiency. We have been a fairly unproductive country. Mumbai, Pune is having about 150 kilometer distance. Dubai, Abu Dhabi is about 180 kilometer distance. On a good day, we traveled from Dubai to Abu Dhabi in about 2 hours, 2 and a quarter hours. On a good day, Mumbai, Pune will still take about 3.5 hours. You are moving about 70-80% faster than we are moving, and that makes us inefficient. Within Abu Dhabi, if we have to travel, I think point-to-point distance will be 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 20 minutes. But if I have to go from BKC to your New Bombay office, and if the Dr. Vellumani expects me to be on time, I don't think I will ever be able to meet his expectation. It will always be difficult to reach on time because of the infrastructure constraints which India has. But within that, we are trying to become efficient. If you see this room, it has all LED bulbs. In 2014, whole of India has about 5 million LED bulbs. We were still using the bulbs invented by Thomas Alva Edison, which was incandescent bulb, which was energy guzzling. Everyone knew buying LED bulbs was cost efficient, but no one bought because for a variety of reasons. When government came to power, they said we must provide power to everyone. And hence they introduced LED bulbs. They gave order for buying 50 million LED bulbs when the country had 5 million LED bulbs. Over last 4 years, they have distributed 310 million LED bulbs, 31 crore LED bulbs. Private parties have introduced another 10 crore. And by putting LED bulbs into people's residences and offices, they are saving about 16,000 crore a year for consumers. And they are saving about 8,000 megawatt a year. Is there a way to verify this? Answer is yes. If you see, this is the picture from National Geography. It shows areas in which night glow is increased between 2012 to 2016, and areas in which night glow is decreased. And India is one country where night glow is increased dramatically. If we zoom in, most parts of India has seen increase in night glow. There are villages which after 70 years of independence for the first time are receiving power. Now there are media houses which will show in that village which house has not received electricity. They forgot to show that for 70 years. But when you travel to those villages, you find people who are now getting power for 12 hours a day, 14 hours a day, 18 hours a day. And this is what the truth is. Can you imagine life without electricity? I met some gentleman today morning who was in Abu Dhabi 49 years ago. And he was sharing his experience ki peene ka pani bhi nahi tha. Abu Dhabi se Dubai jaane ke liye we had to carry compass because there was not even a motorable road. So that's the kind of scenario. What was 50 years back Abu Dhabi and what is today is mind-bogglingly different. A similar kind of trend is happening in many parts of India which are like sub-Saharan Africa. The second thing which is happening is formalization of economy. What happened with Thyrocare, there were many mom and pop pathology labs, and what probably Dr. Velumani has not mentioned, that all these pathological labs were giving cuts to the doctors to get business. It was a corrupt practice, and with companies like Thyrocare, which brought economies of scale, which took out the corrupt practices out, what was worth 500 rupees became 100 rupee, and yet the quality remained the same or better. That's formalization. That's how you create 10,000 jobs. That's how you improve economy. What Dr. Velumani did with Thyrocare is now happening in many parts of India. We make highest amount of cotton in the world. In school, we were told that Egyptian cotton is of good quality. Today, Indian cotton is better than Egyptian cotton. We also know how to convert this cotton into yarn because we have the largest spinning capacity in the world. But when it comes to converting yarn to fabric, we still use handloom and power loom, which were invented in Baba Adam's time. Very limited amount of yarn gets converted on modern automatic looms into fabric. Now what happens? Can you make a garment and brand it like Zara, Van Heusen, Aero on power loom or hand loom? Answer is no. But you can do that in modern textile mills. When you grow cotton, you don't make much money. When you create yarn, you don't make much money. When you create fabric, you don't make much money. But if I convert that fabric into garment and put a brand on it, I'll make a lot of money. We believe in Atithi Devo Bhava. So, mehnat ka kaam hum karte hain aur profit banana kisi aur ke liye chhod dete hain. Our total garment export is $17 billion, and with China whom we want to compete, their total garment export is $300 billion. With what face we can say we are comparable to China? This I will call as India's South Korea movement. For 70 years, we remained in mom and pop economy. Now we are becoming formal economy. How many of you remember Manmohan Desai? Okay. For those of you who are very young, Manmohan Desai was a legendary film director, and all his movies started with lost and found formula. There'll be two brothers, one will become thief, other will become police. One will become rich, other will become poor. There will be complete contradiction. So God also acted like Manmohan Desai, and he created two brothers, India and South Korea. India got independence in 47, Korea got in 48. We were looted by Britishers for 180 years. Koreans got that benefit from Chinese and Japanese. When we became independent, we were divided between India and Pakistan, and we didn't share great relationship with each other forever. Korea had similar benefit in 50 when North and South Korea got created, and except for last 6 months, they were just like India and Pakistan. So we were two identical twins born from same mother equivalent. We were 4 times bigger than South Korea in per capita GDP in 1947. Today, we are at about $2,000 per capita GDP. South Korea is about $32,000 per capita GDP. They are 16 times bigger than us after being 4 times smaller than us in 1947. In about 70 years, they have outperformed us 64 times. Have you ever met a South Korean with 64 legs, 64 hands, 64 heads? Wo bhi apni tarah do haath, do paon, ek sar leke ghoom raha hai. What happened between two identical twins where they outperformed us 64 times in 70 years? I'll give you a small example which will explain why that happened. At the time of independence, India's largest company was Tata Steel. They were the first steel company in Asia. When no one knew how to make steel, Tatas were making steel in India. When independence came, they went to Indian government saying that we have iron ore mines, we have coal mines, we have water, we have land, we have technology, we have capital because we are Tatas. All we need from now is permission to expand our steel capacity. The government of India came out with a legendary law called Monopolies and Restrictive Trade Practices Act, which didn't allow big companies to become bigger. Around the same time in South Korea, there was a company called Pohang Iron and Steel Company, POSCO. They went to their government saying that we don't have iron ore mines, but we'll import. We don't have coal mines, but we'll import. We don't have capital, but we will borrow. We don't have levelized land, but we'll figure out how to create blast furnace. We want permission to make steel, despite all these challenges. The government of South Korea said, Charja beta suli ke upar. POSCO became a bigger steel company than Tata Steel. This focus on mom and pop enterprises, this focus on informal enterprises resulted into India remaining backward. Now we are creating entrepreneurs and businesses which are becoming formal, which are becoming globally competitive. Today there are $200 billion market cap companies from India, TCS and Reliance Industries Limited. Over next decade or so, will we have 20 more such companies? Answer is quite likely. And that's how, sir, was zero ke piche ek aur zero bhi. This is what we have done in automobile sector. This is what we have done in IT sector. Imagine if in IT sector we had mom and pop enterprises. Do you think anyone would have given us export orders? If we were still running 100 premier Padminis rather than one Maruti Suzuki, do you think India's automobile sector would have changed? Today, India is exporting motor cars to Japan. Baleno is made in India, sent to Japan. That's what we have achieved in automobile sector. So this formalization, where mom and pop pathology labs are moving towards thyrocare kind of efficient companies, that will change India. The third thing which is happening is financialization of economy. I mentioned how stupid Indians are in terms of their obsession with gold. If that one error was not good enough, we compounded our error by being obsessed with currency notes. I don't know whether you carry the same trait here or not, but hopefully your wallets will have less dirhams and probably more rupees. This obsession with currency note, because it avoided you payment of taxes, resulted into our savings getting stagnated. When you put 1 rupee in currency into your tijori, it stops, it doesn't circulate. But when you put the same rupee in bank deposits, banks go out and lend and the money starts circulating. 1 rupee in banks creates 7 rupee of economy. 1 rupee in tijori doesn't even create 1 rupee of economy. We remain obsessed with currency, we remain obsessed with gold, and that really crippled our economy. Now, this I will call as India's China movement. In 1984, India and China were of similar size. Today, China is 7 times bigger than us. In 24 years, Chinese have outperformed us 7 times. Again, you don't see a Chinese with 14 heads. They are just like you and me. They outperformed us 7 times in 24 years because of this ratio. They have done many good things, but one big good thing is that India's credit to GDP ratio is 69% and China is at 251%. When their Tatas, Birlas, Ambanis went to their bank to borrow money, their banks were able to give because Chinese savings went into financial instruments, into bank deposits. When our Tata, Birla and Ambani came to raise money, our banks couldn't give money because our savings was going into gold and currency notes. On top of it, we also give money to Nirav Modi. That's a separate thing. But combination of not putting savings at right place has crippled India. Now government is trying to change it. Many analysts come and talk about demonetization is failure of our number one person. Is it failure of Mr. Modi or is it failure of Indians? There was a guy who tried to make people tax compliant, make people honest, and requested them that if you have undeclared money, black income, please don't deposit your money into bank, let it remain with you. And whatever is not written, I will probably use it for rebuilding Indian economy. We as a community came together to deceive him and put all our black money through one way or other into bank accounts. And then we are saying it is your failure, not our failure. This explains why Chinese have outperformed us 7 times in 24 years and why Koreans have outperformed us 64 times in 70 years. Hopefully, our kids. And if you take some media estimate, 1.2 billion people, because 100 million people in India don't wear clothes. We know everything. All we need is a combination of political will, bureaucratic process, which brings all this industry into India. We did this with IT sector. Can we do this with other sectors like textiles, like footwear, like clothing, like soft toys, and so on and so forth? My guess is that we are in the right direction, and we will shift many industries from China into India if we get a stable government. The final thing which is happening in India is digitization. There was a gentleman called Stanley Pignell. He was a reporter from Economist. When he was in India, he could hardly find anything positive about India. Phir usko France bheja. And his first tweet, which I read, was that French banking system is million years behind Indian banking system. In India today, you are in a position to transfer money instantly, courtesy Aadhaar, courtesy UPI, courtesy BHIM. But that doesn't happen in France. A guy who was hardcore critic of India became instant bhakt of India the moment he got transported out of India into France. That's the kind of improvement which we are doing in Indian financial system in digitization. This combination of digitization, formalization, financialization, and efficiency can change India the way Abu Dhabi got changed for better, the way Dubai got changed for better. It's obviously vision of the ruling family, execution by their subordinates, but combination of that vision and execution has created miracle in desert. We are far more blessed in that sense. Is there initial signs of success visible? Well, if you see tax compliance, it has started improving. There were 64 lakh people, business houses, business units which were paying taxes. It has now jumped by more than 75% to 1.12 crore. There were 42 million people who were filing income tax return. It has jumped by about 60%, and now 68 million people are filing income tax return. Finally, my cousins have learned that they have to pay taxes in India. In terms of job creation, jobs have started getting created at a faster pace. Hopefully, this early signs of success will be converted ahead. There will be more lectures by Dr. Vellumani, and more jobs will be created. First time in India, we are seeing promoters paying back bank loans. There was a promoter who said, debt is a permanent equity. Good sir, you didn't hear that before, otherwise your idea about borrowing would have changed. But today, the same gentleman has lost both his giant companies to bankers because he thought debt is payable when able, not debt is payable when it is required. In the Gujarati Marwadi community, arranged marriage is common, just like Madrasi community, sir. And hamare wahan pe beech mein ek intermediary rehta hai. So normally, girl's family will ask the intermediary, samne wale ne bankruptcy kitni baar declare ki hai. If people have declared more bankruptcy, then apni ladki sukhi rahegi. That is the mindset of Gujaratis, Marwadis, Sindhis. But now this is changing because of IBC. Oil is India's Rahu and Ketu. Hamari kundli mein sirf ek hi problem hai, oil ka. Oil upar, India niche. Oil niche, India upar. We send $100 billion every year abroad for import of oil. We are the third largest oil importer in the world, and soon we will become the second largest, and I am sure one day we can become the largest. Many a times I used to think that God is not Indian, because if I see the map of India, to the left of India in Middle East, everyone has got oil. And to the right of India, from Myanmar all the way up to Australia, everyone has got oil and gas. Khali beech mein Bhagwan bhul gaya. But later on I realized that no, God is Indian. He gave polluting oil to everyone else, and he gave us the best non-polluting source of power, solar energy. Since rest of the Indians were like me, thinking that God is not Indian, they forgot how to exploit or utilize this non-polluting power source. In first 67 years of independence, total capacity of India in solar power was just 2.6 gigawatt. Last year we added 8,000 megawatt or 8 gigawatt solar capacity. What was added in first 67 years, we have added more than 3.5 times in just 1 year. Our solar power capacity today stands almost 10 times in 4 years at 23 gigawatt. If I continue to add solar power like this, at some point of time I will be able to go and tell oil manufacturers, oil producers, that boss, aaj tel dena hai, de de, nahi to fir kal se tu tel lene jayega. I wouldn't be surprised if one day oil will be available at zero. Now, is it 2030, 2050 or 2100? That depends upon what we do with our solar power capacity. Finally, we have number one, for which other guys are complaining. Normally we had number one for which Indians were complaining. But this is the complaint given by MasterCard, world's largest card company, to American government. Ki boss, wo India mein ek rupay karke card company hai jisko government push karti rehti hai. And they are switching citizens of India from Visa and Master to rupee. Isn't it music to hear this kind of complaint? How many of you have rupee cards if you visit India? Sir, you should get Bharat Ratna. May your tribe increase. Baki India ko harane ke liye, there is this movie called Thugs of Hindustan. Don't bother to watch it. But usme ek dialogue hai ki Hindustani ko harane ke liye Hindustani hi kafi hai. We are the exception. We are trying to change that rule. If I have to summarize today's India, it's moving from relationship-based economy to rule-based economy. This is the economy which is transiting from whom I know to what actually matters in terms of on-ground rules and regulations. Is there a risk of India? Of course, there is a risk. The risk is risk of self-goal. हमको हरा सके ऐसी बाहर वालों में ताकत नहीं है. हमारा प्रॉब्लम अपने वालों से ही है. एवरीवन नो स्टोरी ऑफ सिंगुर एंड सानन. सिंगुर इज अ रूरल एरिया इन वेस्ट बंगाल. इंडिया इज मोस्ट रिस्पेक्टेड बिजनेस हाउस टाटा वेंट टू सेट अप एन ऑटोमोबाइल प्लांट ओवर देयर. 5 साल मेहनत किया, सबने उसको भगा दिया. दे वेंट टू सानन, अ फार्म लैंड इन गुजरात, एंड दे सेट अप देयर ऑटोमोबाइल प्लांट ओवर देयर. दिस इज नोन टू एवरीवन. व्हाट इज नॉट सो वेल नोन इज व्हाट हैपेंड टू सिंगुर एंड सानन लेटर ऑन. इन सानन टुडे इफ यू गो, इट्स नॉट लाइक सिंगापुर फॉर श्योर. but it is far better than many other parts of India. The bank deposits have crossed 3,000 crore. You see farmers with jobs, their kids going to school, their kids working in auto component factories, automobile factories. There are malls and there is air of prosperity. You go to Singur, every bank which wanted to set up a branch over there for Tata Motors business is now shutting down because there is no business. There is complete despondency. And the farmers who threw Tata Motors out are now praying that Tata Motors should come back. If rest of India is going to follow Sanand model, this is the best time to invest in India. All you have to then find out is a promoter like Dr. Vellumani, who will work hard for you and on top of it will entertain you for free. If the rest of India is going to follow Sanand, rest of India is going to follow Singur model, this is the best time to exit India. You will be proud that you take decision to move away from India. I hope and pray that India will follow Sanand model more, then they will follow Singur model. Will we 100% follow Sanand model? Answer is no. Will we follow 100% Singur model? Answer is definitely no. We just need to ensure that proportion of Sanand vis-a-vis Singur continues to increase. What should we do? There is a lot you can do to make money for yourself as well as ourselves. One, you need to pray to keep oil prices lower. Second, if you can't vote, at least influence your relatives back in India that they should not take a holiday on election day. They should go and vote. If people vote sensibly, we get a stable government. All the work done on financialization, formalization, digitization, efficiency will produce many more Thyrocares, many more Dr. Vellumani, and that 1-0 might become 2-0. So that's all I have to talk about India. I hope all of you become good investors rather than traders, make a lot of money. Thank you.
Singur and Sanand is in India. Country Risk is outside India. Can you highlight on the country risk than the risk between the states?
So external risk will always be there, but that's part and parcel of investment. US interest will go up, they'll come down. Oil prices will go up, they'll come down. In 70 years, our history, we were not left behind because we had external risk. We were left behind because we had internally committed to Singur rather than Sanand. That is my version of story. Take it or leave it.
So, Dinesh bhai, one is, of course, what Mr. Vellumani also said, Dr. Vellumani. So, you did knock on the doors for 350 crores when the issue was closed. After hearing him today, probably you'll knock for 700 crores. So, that's where another zero would come. But you've not spoken about the capital markets in terms of what we can expect into how the future next 1 or 2 years, especially the volatile year of the political situation now, the elections, how the equity markets are going to behave in, say, the next 12 months, what investment decisions we should take, remain invested, sell out, what should we do?
So one, it's very difficult to predict what will happen in election. Our track record in predicting municipal election is not so good that I can afford to take a call on the general election. But India's story is not about election. In 23 years history of Thyrocare, they have seen Chandrasekhar government for 6 months and collapsing. They have seen Rajiv Gandhi getting assassinated. They have seen Narasimha Rao government coming, standing, coming. They have seen Devegowda and Inder Kumar Gujral government. They have seen all kinds of political situation, and yet the company has grown. So if you are taking call on India, take a longer term call. Yes, in May 2019, if we get stable government, markets could be up 20% or down 20%. But on a longer term basis, elections wouldn't matter. If we get our act together on these four mega trends, this will be mind-boggling opportunity. When Infosys started Y2K, no one would have thought that this will become $30, $40, $50 billion company. In 1995-96, could you have thought that TCS will be bigger than Accenture? It would have been impossible, but we achieved that. What was Y2K in IT sector, you have supply chain disruption in the entire manufacturing sector. The opportunity is ours. Should we go and capture it? If we capture that manufacturing opportunity, we'll probably create another China over the next 20 years. China today is $11 trillion economy. India has ability to create similar opportunity over the next two decades. We are today at $2.5 trillion. Imagine the growth coming from just one supply chain disruption. So there is a huge opportunity. We just have to go and capture it.
Hi, Dinesh Bhai. Thank you so much for such an informative session. You've come like, you know, chitthi aaye type, because you brought all the good news to us. What I'd like to ask is, one thing, India has consumed most of its production. So that has been very good for India for a long time, and we say that is why India has sustained the financial crisis very well and stuff. The second thing is, China is not a democracy. Not having a democracy is a boon in one way, because you can grow the way you want. With the democracy, what India has done is probably unparalleled and very good. So how do you factor these two things and then tell the India story?
So one, it is an oxymoron to say that democratic state cannot grow fast and only autocratic state grows. We have an example in India of a state of Gujarat. It's a democratic state. For last 15 years, Gujarat's annual growth rate is higher than China's annual growth rate. Gujarat does not get foreign direct investment like China. So, you don't remember the Nav Nirman Andolan. There were many more Hardik Patels at that point of time. India has shown a model in Gujarat and maybe some other state, where despite democracy or because of democracy, we can grow as fast as China. It is all about the citizens. It is all about creating entrepreneurs like Dr. Vellumani. We have one Vellumani who created Thyrocare. We have to create 1,000 Vellumani. Automatically, India will be bigger than China. And aisa nahi hai ki unka life matlab bed of roses tha. सर आपने बोला वॉरेन बफे से कंपैरिजन करने के लिए मैं भी थोड़ा लगा रहा हूं सो इफ यू सी इन टर्म्स ऑफ ह्यूमन डेवलपमेंट इंडेक्स केरला इज वन ऑफ द बेस्ट आई हैव हर्ड दिस मोर ऑफन एंड इफ देर आर मलयाली ओवर हियर एंड दे आर लाइकली टू बी And if I offend them in any wrong way, I'm sorry about it. But I have always heard from my Malayali friend that the moment you take Malayali out of Kerala, he is the most efficient and hardworking person. But inside of Kerala, sometimes that is not true, or most of the time that is not true. So again, Kerala has shown us a fantastic model on human development. Gujarat has shown us a fantastic model on entrepreneurship. We can probably pick and choose, like Punjab and Western UP showed us a fantastic model on agriculture. A very limited success story of India, which people haven't heard, is about milk. We were the importer of milk. we were feeding our kids with Scandinavian countries' gift of milk powder, which was not fit for human consumption in their country. But we didn't have a choice. So right from Mahabharata days, when Drona's wife gave that flour into water and shown as a milk to Aswatthama, till 1960, we had no milk. वो खाली अपने को बोलते थे कि इंडिया में घी दूध की नदियाँ बहती थी. इन महाभारत इट वॉज नॉट गोइंग, इन 1960 इट वॉज नॉट ग्रोइंग. या सो टिल 1960 वी वेर एब्सोल्यूट डिपेंडेंट अपॉन इम्पोर्टेड मिल्क पाउडर. देन देर वॉज अ जेंटलमैन कॉल्ड त्रिभुवन दास पटेल. He was nominated by Sardar Patel and Morarji Desai to do something for milkmen of Anand. Those two gentlemen came together to set up what is known as Amul today. They were lucky to get a Keralite who was more Gujarati than most Gujarati. Dr. Varghese Kurian came. And he scaled up this to a completely different level. And this all happened within the constraints of democracy by fighting multinational companies. Today, India's largest FMCG companies, neither Patanjali, nor Hindustan Unilever, nor Nestle, nor PepsiCo, nor Coca-Cola, it is a homegrown company called Amul. It doesn't employ any IIT, IIM. It works with uneducated farmers, but they have lots of common sense. Again, without being stereotype, it is run by a Sardarji. And they have created wonder. Today, India is the world's largest producer of milk. And whenever there is natural calamity, we end up contributing milk to and milk powder to other countries. What we did in milk, we have to do it in clothing, textiles, footwear, food processing. Next 20 years, we'll reach reasonably close to China. Thank you.
Hi. My question, one last question, is about our profession. The last 3 years, I think the chartered accountant has suffered a beating in terms of reputation. And I think it's serious that we do something quickly so that we can take part in the growth of India. As a chartered accountant, what would you think we should do to salvage our reputation?
We have a fantastic role model in Dr. Yesdi Malegaum, Dr. Bansi Mehta. Even today, when Mr. Malegaum speaks, the whole country listens. They were the guys who created brand of chartered accountant. And I'm sure there were many more Malegaums who I don't know. But we have a role model. Somewhere as a community, we forgot what Dr. Malegaum stood for. I still remember in our chartered accountancy course, we were told how in Raymond Limited, Dr. Malegaum resigned as the auditor of the company because they didn't want to sign a particular notes to accounts. If we can create followers of Dr. Malegaum, Bansi Mehta equivalent, I don't think so, brand chartered accountant, anyone can stop. But if we have forgotten the values and the work of Malegaum and Bansi Mehta, then our brand will get damaged. It is up to us to follow the path of Malegaum and Bansi Mehta. And there are so many others. So these are the two people whom I know. But there will be probably many such people who have contributed to create brand chartered accountant. Thank you.
Hi, Nilesh Bhai. Hello. Excuse me. Nilesh Bhai, here, just last question. Only it will take 30 minutes, 1 minute. 30 seconds, 1 minute. Thank you for giving the presentation on Indian economy so aptly. I have always been an ardent follower since day one I met you at Ambuja Cement when I used to work with Mr. Anil Singh and Mr. Jayesh Doshi. Then I got an opportunity to work directly under you and with Mr. Sunil Shat and Access Direct. So my question is related more towards the current trade war situation which is going on between US and China and other economies. What if it percolates more, and what is the immediate opportunities which can, you know, being an Indian or Indian economy can get? Thank you so much.
Sure. So बचपन में अपने को एक कहानी सुनाया था दो बंदर का और एक बिल्ली का. Two bandar had a roti. They were fighting on that roti. And the billi took the entire roti by adjudicating between two bandars. So one bandar is US, the second bandar is China. They are fighting on the tariff war. Can Indians become selfish to be that billi who can take that entire roti for itself? In the past, we have never been selfish. We have always believed in Atithi Devo Bhava. But can we go to Amazon and Walmart and request them that, dekho bhaiya, you have been buying maximum Chinese goods. Now there is a tariff war. Your suppliers, you are requesting them to move from China to some other place. Why don't you add they should move to India? To Amazon, I can say that, look, I have given you free entry in India, a market of 1.3 billion people. You have been thrown out from China. You can never ever enter China against Alibaba. In fact, the risk is that Alibaba will come and throw you out of America. But hum log to Atithi Devo Bhava wale hain. So please help me. We can go to Walmart. They have put in $16 billion in Flipkart. It is their largest investment outside of America. Walmart is a giant in US, but outside of US, they have been utter failure. Can we go to them and say that, look, I will help you to become a brand success, a model success in India, but saath mein thoda ye help kar de. So if we develop the trait of billi to take the entire roti, we will benefit from the tariff war. But if we don't do that, then there is a risk. Now, very recently, there was a newspaper announcement that Facebook is going to set up their largest data center in Singapore. This will be their first data center in Asia. This will entail investments of about $1 billion. Now when data center comes, data analytics comes. In India, IT companies are not that big in data analytics yet. They are more in code writing and application management. Now in Asia, who are the largest users of Facebook? Indians. In the world, who are the largest users of Facebook? Indians. Should our data be kept in Singapore's data center? Can we have someone who can lift a phone to Mark Zuckerberg and say, dekh bhaiya Mark, hamra data tu wahan kyun leke ja raha hai, yahin pe rakh de. If we do that, we create $1 billion investment in India, and I create future Infosys in data analytics. All we need is this kind of Biladi mentality. I hope our number one is doing that job.
Thank you, Nileshji. No more questions now. Your session could not be concised in just 1 hour. I know there are a lot of questions for you, but we'll have to restrict to the time. I'd like to invite Chapter Chairman C. Ashish Bhandari, Committee Member C. Ajay Singhvi, and C. B. S. Moni to please come over and present a token of appreciation to C. Nileshji.